Hey everybody, welcome back to Engaging the Phenomenon, and welcome back to the Others series. In this series, The Others, we speculate and theorize on the intelligence behind the UFO phenomenon. So, in this episode, we're focusing on the ETH, the extraterrestrial hypothesis. And generally, the extraterrestrial hypothesis represents UFOs being from outer space, meaning there's different, the intelligence behind the UFO phenomenon are extraterrestrials from other planets somewhere out in space. And this once was the primary and most popular theory regarding UFO intelligence, aka aliens. So much of that has been seen in pop culture, and that idea has almost been beaten into us over several decades of science fiction and even conspiracy and UFO programs, all kind of a lot of them mainly focusing on aliens from outer space, the extraterrestrial hypothesis. Now, back in Jacques Vallée's day, he once was a proponent for the ETH, and then he went on to change his mind and had been quoted saying, if UFOs only turn out to be little green men, I'll be awfully disappointed. It's a pretty, you know, vast universe. And that makes a lot of sense. And I want to emphasize here that, you know, the UFO intelligence can represent many different things. So, say that some UFOs are interdimensional, that doesn't rule out the extraterrestrial hypothesis as a valid hypothesis or argument for at least some fraction of the UFO phenomenon. And I'm going to argue that out of everything we've seen over, even let's just say since the 1940s until now, I think it's highly probable that at least some UFOs represent extraterrestrial intelligence in some way, shape, or form. Now, that's not to say that we're not dealing with other intelligences like ultra-terrestrials or interdimensionals or other, even something stranger maybe. So, one of the reasons I want to say that the extraterrestrial hypothesis is highly valid is just look at our understanding of space and even the last few decades. It used to be that, you know, we thought there were like some galaxies out there, but now we know that, you know, our Milky Way galaxy is at the least 100,000 light years across. You know, the human brain can barely fathom what that means and what that includes. You know, you're talking about billions of solar systems within our own galaxy. And then there's hundreds of billions of galaxies, some equal in size, some larger than ours, out there in space. So the idea that there's no extraterrestrials out there is, by today's standards, ridiculous. Even all the mainstream scientists and astrophysicists agree, of course there's extraterrestrials, but their argument is that those extraterrestrials could never reach us because we're too far away. And I think that's extremely narrow-minded. If we just take a look back in history, all these things that we saw as impossible, some simple things we do on a daily basis now. You know, the first computers were the size of like a house, you know, or an entire room. Now we have a phone in our hand that's vastly more powerful, that sent the first man to the moon, and it's in our hand, and we have the internet with it and all these other things that they never had, and we're doing these things routinely. So that's just, you know, several decades of advancements. Imagine an intelligence an extraterrestrial intelligence that had 1,000 years, 10,000 years, 100,000 years, 1,000,000 years of technological development advancement, post AI, whatever the heck that could even, you know, imply, post quantum computing. Not to say they would necessarily have the same technological curves as us, but maybe something similar at least. So an extraterrestrial intelligence that is vastly older than us has the potential to be, you know, vastly superior in technology and understanding, the way that they see physics, the way that they can not break physics necessarily, but the way that they can bend physics with their understanding of it. So I think that the extraterrestrial hypothesis, maybe not the only explanation for UFO intelligence, but certainly a valid one for some of what is observed. And another curious thing to think about is these talks about crash retrievals. Now that, I mean, it would seem with crash retrievals that, well, if there's beings here coming in some kind of ship and they crash and there's some kind of entities or life forms, you know, because they're within our world or universe, does that mean that they're, you know, from our universe? And that's that. I mean, that just boggles my mind. Could an interdimensional be just as physical as us? That's just some questions to leave you with. But again, I just think, in my opinion, while the extraterrestrial hypothesis might not be the only explanation, I certainly think it's a valid one even to this day. But I do think that we are dealing with a broad spectrum of phenomena. I do think that arguments like interdimensional or the ultra-terrestrial hypothesis are also extremely valid in their own way. But now I'm going to hand it off to Exoacademian.
Ever since people started looking up in the sky and seeing things they couldn't identify, things that looked too technologically advanced to be human technology, the assumption was these must be extraterrestrial visitors. By definition, beings piloting advanced vehicles from other worlds. At first, the assumption was these were perhaps invasion forces from nearby planets like Mars or Venus. But as we began to learn more about our own solar system and how lifeless those worlds apparently were, the distances expanded and we started imagining creatures that were coming here from other solar systems, from far-flung planets far, far away. To many people, this still seems like the most likely argument, the most likely source for these others. After all, we have surveyed the Earth extensively. We have not found other humanoid creatures that look anything like the Greys or the Reptilians or the Mantids or any creature like that. And again, these craft do not seem to be human-made. They do not seem to be technology that's from the United States, Russia, China, or anything like that. And therefore, the assumption is, again, these must be from elsewhere, extraterrestrial by definition. Dr. Jacques Vallée was one of the first figures to champion this idea that we were having visitors coming here from some other solar system, from some other part of the galaxy. And this was his argument for a long time, and he lobbied for this. But as he gathered evidence and looked at the data in its entirety and saw even connections with a distant past and what he saw as a phenomenon that's been manifesting different facade structures, but the underlying source going back well into human history, and it's therefore not a contemporary phenomenon, he began to question the ETH, the extraterrestrial hypothesis. Now, when it comes to this ETH, the most common critique of this hypothesis is the sheer distances involved. Since we know these beings are not coming from some other planet in our solar system, that seems highly unlikely. Then when we look at the other candidates, the nearby planets beyond our solar system are still so, so far away that even vehicles approaching the speed of light would take a very, very long time to get here. these distances are so astronomical that sometimes we don't realize just how far away these other planets would be and how long it would take to get here. In addition to this most common argument that's a critique of the ETH, Jacques Vallée went on to identify five other arguments that he had against this ETH in a paper that he wrote in 1990 titled Five Arguments Against the Extraterrestrial Origin of Unidentified Flying Objects. Those arguments are as follows. Number one, unexplained close encounters are far more numerous than required for any physical survey of the Earth. What he's getting at here is that when you add up the number of sightings, the number of reported abductions, that's far more than would be necessary for a species that supposedly had traveled that great distance just to survey the Earth in a kind of scientific expedition. His second argument from this paper is the humanoid body structure of the alleged aliens is not likely to have originated on another planet and is not biologically adapted to space travel. What Vallée is getting at here is these creatures look remarkably humanoid. They look almost like relatives of us, perhaps a branch off of us. They look like they have bodies that are adapted to this very Earth. And the argument is if they came from some far-flung planet, then likely their body structure would be different because the chances of them coming from a planet similar to Earth, where they would evolve similar body structures, seems highly unlikely. Now, the second part where he mentions them not looking like they are biologically adapted to space travel, that argument is less strong in my mind. We really don't know what that would entail, and a species that's advanced enough to traverse the great distances of space would no doubt have figured out how to handle that. Jacques' third argument is the reported behavior in thousands of abduction reports contradicts the hypothesis of genetic or scientific experimentation on humans by an advanced race. What he's getting at here is the abduction accounts themselves seem very bizarre, very strange, sometimes almost sadistic, almost occult-like in terms of the procedures that are conducted upon people. And this just does not seem to fit well with the idea of a scientifically advanced race that would be here to conduct surveys of the Earth, perhaps do a genetic mapping of our body structure, our DNA, but they would not conduct the kind of experiments or kind of strange procedures that people report in abductions. Jacques' fourth argument was the extension of the phenomenon throughout recorded human history demonstrates that UFOs are not a contemporary phenomenon. And I touched on this already. What Jacques is getting at here is when he studied distant human history, our mythology, our religions, he began to believe that the same underlying phenomenon may have just been manifesting in different ways. The surface structure may have changed over time, but space travelers may just be the most recent manifestation. Again, perhaps designed to work with our current understanding of what's next, but the underlying structure being the same as the angels and demons that were seen in centuries past. And Jacques' fifth argument is the apparent ability of UFOs to manipulate space and time suggests radically different and richer alternatives. And what he's getting at here is if evidently they can manipulate space and time directly, the very fabric of reality, so to speak, in ways that we have no capacity to understand really, then they could be from anywhere and any time. And again, this notion of space travelers from some planet far flung distant from us, again, is sort of our mentality. It's what we jump to in terms of a conclusion, but that may be just a facade that we're being shown. And their ability to manipulate the fabric of reality itself suggests a much more complex and, in Jacques' understanding, interesting notion. So those are Jacques' five arguments against the ETH as a singular explanation for the phenomenon. Again, when he looks at the way they can manipulate space-time, the way that they apparently may have been here all along, manifesting in different ways, manipulating even our ability to perceive them. Directly, they can manipulate our perceptions, so we don't even know that what we're seeing is in some way, quote-unquote, real. It may be a facade, and the base reality may be different altogether. We just don't know. And I understand Jacques' point of view. My understanding is that these source of these others may be partly extraterrestrial. I don't exclude the extraterrestrial hypothesis altogether. I do agree with Jacques, however, that it's not the sole explanation and it's not sufficient on its own. Besides, though, I think that because they are so technologically ahead of us, so even psychologically, spiritually, energetically ahead of us, their understanding of consciousness itself seems to be far beyond ours, that the ultimate explanation, the answer we're looking for, is much more complex than we can probably even conceive of right now. And the ETH is probably one part, one aspect of a much more complex ultimate explanation. I also think it's important to point out that while we refer to the totality of these events as the phenomenon, really it is phenomena. I believe we are likely going to find that there are multiple sources causing these events, not just one. And I think it's likely we will find that some of those intelligences actually are originating from our own physical universe and have found a way to traverse those great distances. We have conceptions of perhaps using something like black holes or white holes to find shortcuts, to fold space, as it were, to shorten those distances. It may be something like that. It may be something beyond what we can even conceive of. But I do think it's likely that there are species here that have come from within our own physical universe, and that this notion that the great distances involved are just too much to overcome, I think that's a weak argument, too bound to our earthly thinking. After all, we've gone from horses and buggies to spacecraft in about 100 years. So just imagine the kind of technological possibilities that exist for a species that may be thousands of years ahead of us. Really, we can't even conceive of it if we're honest with ourselves. So there you have it. That's my take on the ETH in a nutshell. I think it's one aspect of what we are observing in what we collectively refer to as the phenomenon.
Hey guys, thank you so much for tuning in to Engaging the Phenomenon, and thank you so much for tuning in to our series, The Others, where we contemplate, speculate, and theorize regarding the intelligence behind the UFO phenomenon. Be sure to subscribe to the channel and stay tuned for more, because we will be covering other theories behind the intelligence behind the UFO phenomenon. Be sure to look in the description and check out ExoAcademian's YouTube channel and podcast. We'll see you guys next time on Engaging the Phenomenon. Take care.